Good morning. Happy Easter. Vesa Wego, Alleluia. He is risen. He is truly risen. In today's responsorial psalm, we hear these beautiful words. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Alleluia, Alleluia. It's so wonderful to be able to say those words, Alleluia, Alleluia. We have not said them the entire Easter season. And so to be able to say them today releases such whatever is within us, to be able to just shout at the top of our lungs, He is risen, Alleluia. I used Vesa Wego, Alleluia, because that is in the Polish language, and I have such fond memories of when I was a child. My mom and would take me to the Easter Sunday rise services in the Polish church, filled to the brim with people, children in First Communion outfits, lilies, signs of whiteness and purity and hope and joy, just walking in procession around the church, singing those very words, Vesa Wego, Alleluia, He is risen. Joy, relief, tears, all at once. In the long, sometime very painful Lenten journey that you and I have been on, we have been transformed. Let's hope so, anyway. We learn that the end is not the end, that life actually wins. The crucified one is now the risen one. And this terrible, tragic story has a happy ending, almost too good to be true, and it remains so. In so many moments of your life and my life, relief opens floodgates to feelings that we were holding just under the surface, especially now during this pandemic, when we might be able to hug our families for the first time after a long quarantine, or maybe finding out that our COVID test was positive or some other test that we were going through, ringing the bell after a last chemo treatment. When long waits and hard journeys are over, so many feelings come to in one moment, feelings of relief, joy, and tears. Imagine the wild, intertwined emotions of the disciples seeing the empty tomb and the resurrected Jesus. Oh my God, I don't know what I would have done. I don't know what I would have done. But after the death of Jesus and after the Sabbath had passed, some very brave women go to his borrowed tomb in order to anoint his body. They were undoubtedly in despair. The one they had hoped in had been killed, but yet they wanted to honor his body and to do what they could do. So they went to the tomb where Jesus was buried. And in spite of their own fears and trepidation, very early in the morning, they went there. The tomb where Jesus was laid was like a cave in which bodies were to be placed. The entrance was secured with a very large stone, a stone that one person could not open. And if the women were to attend to Jesus' body, they knew that they would need help to roll that stone back. However, when they arrived at the tomb, the stone had been moved. They looked into the tomb and they were astonished because the body of Jesus was not there. Instead, the cloths were laid nicely folded and there was a person sitting there on the stone in white. Tradition has it that it was an angel. Accounts of this encounter differ in detail. However, each account has the angel saying three very distinct things. He has been raised. Do not be afraid and go and tell the others. With these three admonitions, the meaning of Lent is finally very clear. And the length to which God's love will go is made visible in his Son, Jesus. This love will carry us and all of our sins, our weaknesses, our blindnesses, and our smallness into and through death. All the worst that can happen to us, all the worst that we can do, these are held by Jesus as he cries out, forgive them. Because that love is stronger than anything, God raises Jesus from the dead. God's love is life and life for us. God's love is stronger than anything that we can do to thwart it. He has been raised. The second message, do not be afraid, addresses the state of the women. They were astonished, confused, bewildered, frightened. Just as the angel's first statement was meant for all of them, it is also meant for us. The triumph of the cross and the raising of Jesus can take away our fears as well. All is forgiven. Mercy and love triumph. God's loving kindness is stronger than everything, even death. We need no longer fear. Our hearts can be at ease in this mercy. And then finally, the angel tells the women to go and tell others. And with these words, the angel gives the first call to discipleship, the call to proclamation. The Gospels are good news. They are a story filled with conflict, misunderstanding, suffering, and altogether bad behavior. They're also a story of healing, sensitivity, welcome, compassion, constancy of love, strength amid weakness, of life and death. God has shown the lens to which God will go to save each one of us and to draw us close. The stone is gone. That which blocked us and all of our lives has been called away. That which we fear no longer carries power. We have something wonderful to tell. The stone has gone away. The love and loyalty of Mary and the other women who come to that cave are rewarded as their grief returns to joy and they experience the risen Christ. Flooded with conflicting emotions, Mary Magdalene and the other women run. They run, their hearts pounding, to tell the others. Their message sparks John and Peter to run to the empty tomb to see for themselves because they don't believe the women. Previously broken and grieving, Mary, John, Peter allow joy now to inspire them, to animate them, and to quite literally move them. Even now, right here and now, you and I can see the light through the darkness of the pandemic. We have vaccines, and so many of us have gotten those vaccine shots. Spring returns, and the earth comes alive before our eyes. Even now, God is turning our sorrow into joy, our desolation to a garden. Our hope for new life swells again, even if the threat is not fully diminished. Many dangers were still ahead for Mary, John, and Peter, but in the light of Easter morning, they faced the world with a new confidence, assured by the joy of the resurrection. They witnessed a fulfillment of God's covenant. Even more, they witnessed the promise of the new covenant, the new and eternal covenant that would sustain them and us throughout our lives. We come to trust in God, ever present, deeply compassionate, even when we feel distant. At a time when we may have questioned God's presence, resurrection reminds us of a God who perpetually whispers to us, I am with you. Today, remade by Easter grace, you and I leave the vacant graves where our broken hearts may have lingered. We are new beings in the resurrected Christ. The world's disguise has been rolled away like the boulder at the tomb. We see all creation as the expression of the Holy Spirit. Our life is a journey that flows from where we set our heart, and our hearts hold our relationships to God in mystery, paradox, questions, pain, grace, gratitude, until it completely transforms us and gives us new life. For each one of us, belief in the resurrection is more than the words we say. It is about the way we respond, how you and I respond to others right here and right now. And like those first disciples, you and I, let us go rejoicing this day to our sisters and brothers. Let us assure them by our actions, by our words, by our belief, by our love, today, tomorrow, and forever, that Christ is indeed alive. Desuego, alleluia. He is risen. Christ is truly risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. And so now, in the spirit of Easter, in the spirit of resurrection, as we continue our life's journey, we need to ask ourselves, in the way I serve others, is my heart set on things above, on the resurrected Christ? How will the hearts of those I encounter and serve be touched today, tomorrow, and always? Will they experience an empty tomb or an encounter for resurrected life. My hope is that through our journey of Lent to this day of resurrection, that you and I will always experience that resurrected life. Blessed be God, alleluia. He is risen. He is truly risen. Amen.